us.
Said you were something else. Yeah, right.
We didn't do that.
No, no. So as you mentioned, infectious disease physician, I know this is a dumb thing, but I think it kind of illustrates exactly where we're at in this country right now. But that would seem to be like maybe you were sitting around the office a lot until about 2 weeks ago.
I wouldn't say we were sitting around the office, but suddenly things got a lot busier about 2 weeks ago.
Right. No,
but what does your year look like when a virus like this is not the main focus? What happens the rest of the time that you work there?
Sure. About a quarter of our business is working in the hospital, taking care of folks that have complicated infectious diseases where they end up on the ventilator in the intensive care unit, managing drug-resistant, antibiotic-resistant infections, taking care of folks with, in this part of the country, Lyme disease, some of the other tick-borne illnesses in the summertime months, also working on some of the infectious diseases from mosquitoes and the other things that you'll see in this part of the country.
Right, so what makes this one tricky? I mean, we can dive right into it here, but why is this one such a pain in the ass?
Yeah, so coronavirus or COVID-19 is new to humans. This really was a virus that was circulating in animals previously, likely made this transition from the animal population to humans somewhere in these wet markets in China in December 2019. And the important thing with this virus is once it made that transition into the human population, it is now being effectively transmitted from human to human. And that's been the big challenge. We haven't seen this virus before, and now we are having to deal with the downstream consequences of that.
Interesting. The wet markets you're talking about, I had heard somebody speaking about this a couple of days ago. Basically, a wet market is just a market where people in China and a lot of the large cities in China and such go to buy food, correct?
That's correct.
And so could it have been like an odd food that maybe we here in America would never think of eating? Something like, because somebody was mentioning that, you know, maybe it was a bat or something like that. Do we have that kind of thing zeroed in on at all?
It's likely that it originated in bats, but it likely also had an intermediate host. It might have been one of the animals that we're seeing from these wet markets. So ultimately made the transition to humans through that mechanism.
How frustrating is it for you to follow this in the media? Because there's a whole bunch of people screaming mass panic. There's a whole bunch of people screaming the opposite, saying we're all overreacting. There are health professionals like yourself trying to get out facts and what we know and numbers. And we have a lot of people the last handful of years not sure what organizations we can trust anymore. And where do we go for the facts? Where do we go for the plan, right? Not just people's opinions. How frustrating is it for you to feel like you have a pretty good grasp on what we should be doing, can be doing, have the capabilities of doing, and you're just hearing people spit nonsense and taking shots in the dark?
And I don't know if it's necessarily frustrating. I think the North Star, at least in the state of Minnesota for folks, should be the Minnesota Department of Health. They are world-renowned, really, in the work that they do, and I think the if you're looking for direction, look for the message coming out of that health department. They're world class in what they do. I think our role as healthcare providers, clinics, hospitals, healthcare systems, is really to get the facts out to people and not have the extra hype and the extra sort of message around this that's going to bring panic. I think I appreciate venues like this one to just be able to get out there and talk about what we know and what we can control.
There's a lot of questions in that exact vein. And Sauce and Criso, please feel free to jump in as well.
Yeah.
And I have a lot of questions from Twitter. But here's my big one. And by the way, that Minnesota Department of Health, the website for that is health.state.mn.us. You could just do what I did, run a Google search for Department of Health, Minnesota as well. But that's the website. So that's a great place for us to get our information. But here's the bottom line. If I woke up this morning, what symptom should I be concerned about if I woke up and I had a runny nose, or I woke up and I had a cough, or I woke up and I had a fever? What should I be looking out for?
I think the sort of the constellation of symptoms, cough, fever, shortness of breath, has been the sort of classic presentation for COVID-19 thus far. We've seen some other oddball things, like some people will have some stomach symptoms like diarrhea, but the vast majority, this is a respiratory illness, fever, cough, shortness of breath. At this time of year in Minnesota, the hard part of that is this is also when we're seeing influenza. We've peaked with our influenza season in the last 4 weeks, certainly in the state, and making the difference between those two has been the challenge for folks coming in to be tested and for the clinicians that are involved as well.
And that, of course, as you just said, that causes panic as well, because you, like we saw with a couple people, Fred Hoiberg, he had influenza A, but now anytime anyone looks sick at all, you're like, you can't be around me. You have the coronavirus. That's right. A huge problem.
And I think importantly on that front, in Minnesota right now, we don't have evidence of community spread of infection. All of the cases that we have seen thus far in the state of Minnesota are travel related.
State that one more time for me.
Correct. So at this point in the state of Minnesota, it's not to say that it can't happen, but at this point, all of the cases of COVID-19 in the state have been imported from people traveling elsewhere and bringing the infection back. So their exposure happened outside of the state.
Wow.
It's not to say that we won't see community spread, but we do not have evidence of that yet in Minnesota.
So what happens, I think yesterday, I think the number was 9. I don't know if it's gone up by a couple, but if it was, let's just say it was 9 yesterday.
Yep.
If all of those are outside sources and we have 9 people that are marked as having COVID-19 or coronavirus, what's the protocol? What happens around those 9 to make sure that those 9 haven't spread it throughout the community? How do they track that?
Great question. So these are getting into public health terms a little bit. So what you do with someone that has the disease, so COVID-19, is isolate that person. Home quarantine is usually sort of the model for those that are exposed to those people. But for the person that actually has it, there isn't a treatment. We don't have an antiviral medicine to treat COVID-19. That said, the vast majority of people, 80% that get it, will get better without needing any significant level of care. It's sort of like a really bad cold in some individuals. The symptoms get better and they go on about their business and don't need any additional treatment. 20% get sick enough where they actually need a higher level of care, and that's the group that we're most worried about seeing a big spike in. As a consequence, that's the message around hand washing and cover your cough and staying away from sick people and making sure that you're doing all the little things that you can do to prevent this from spreading. For the individuals that are then infected, they're isolating to home, and again, the vast majority are able to be in their home and not require hospitalization. For those that they exposed, those folks are oftentimes on a 14-day quarantine. So this is why you're seeing travel restrictions that have ramped up in the last several days being a big deal for people coming back to Minnesota from a lot of places around the world. Early on, this was China, Iran, Italy, South Korea, added Japan to that list. As of 2 nights ago, now we've added 26 European countries as well to that list of folks that if they were to come back as an employee at Health Partners, where I work, they would go on home quarantine for 14 days and not be exposed to patients because they've been in an area where coronavirus or COVID-19 is circulating in the community.
So, Dr. Sanis, we've heard a lot in the news about the concern about lack of testing. That South Korea, that is what helped them get a hold of it and really minimize the impact, and that the United States is light years behind them in our response. What is our current state as far as the testing availability kits?
Great question. Out of the gate, we were behind. I think we were slow to get testing going. We had fairly stringent criteria for who to test early on. It was based out of a scarcity of testing kits being available. That is changing rapidly in the United States. And I think at this point in the state of Minnesota, most of us will be probably switching over to commercial labs in the next week or two, such that we will have not unlimited testing capabilities, but really if anyone has exposure to COVID-19, if anyone has symptoms compatible with COVID-19, we're really going to be very loose with who gets tested, I suspect, in the very near future. So the really stringent criteria from early on are likely to get loosened significantly in the next several days.
What do you say to the people that say it's just the flu?
This isn't just the flu, and I think that's why we take this very seriously. In a given flu year, 1 in 1,000 people will die of complications from the flu. On a large scale in the United States, that's somewhere in the order of 30,000 people die of flu every year. The China experience with this early on really would suggest that about 1 in 50 people die of complications from COVID-19. It's a very different number, and taken to scale, you can imagine that that's a much bigger deal, and I think it's why we're taking this so seriously. Even though the vast majority of people, so I'll remind folks again, 80% of folks that get it, that actually get infected, will recover without needing any additional treatment. It's that 20% that we're trying to control and really shrink the number of folks coming in at the top of this funnel so that we can handle the capacity. of the healthcare system can handle the capacity of those that ultimately are in that 20% that land in our hospitals, that land in our ICUs. If 5% of that total number that get infected land in our intensive care units, we need to keep that total number small.
If you're listening to the Power Trip, you're just tuning in and you're saying, that's weird, that person sounds smart. You're right. Yeah. That's Dr. Mark Sanis, infectious disease physician at Park Nicollet and senior medical director for medical specialties and health partners. A bunch of questions. We'll get to some of the Twitter questions as well, but this is going really, really well. I'll go next if you don't mind. Once you get it, let's say you've spoken about you may have it very light symptoms. You may have it get a little bit sick. Are you immune from it once you've had it, or could you get it again?
Great question, and the honest answer is we don't know. This is a virus that's still pretty new to us, and a lot of the research that's necessary to answer your question is being done. That said, if it behaves like SARS, which was another coronavirus that came out in 2003, it's likely that we generate antibodies to this virus and are unlikely to get it again. We just can't say that with certainty.
Well, let me just open up to general unknowns. And what else do we not know about this? Because I've heard multiple people throwing out information about like the weather and whether it heats up and whether that will help kill it. Some people say, yep, that's kind of how this is going to work. Or they're saying, we don't know yet because this is new. So what else is unknown even in your field about the virus?
Yeah, I think your question about whether we'll see similar to influenza, we can predict, right? Every year as the colder weather months in this part of the country come, we see a spike. And then as warmer weather arrives, we'll see it settle down and sort of go away. With COVID-19, it would certainly be great if that was the case, that we saw, you know, that we're seeing the worst of this now and that it's going to get better. The honest answer is we don't know, because we are uncertain if we are still going to see a lot of transmission of this virus as people start distancing a little bit more as we get back outside in this part of the country. You know, the whole thought behind some of the events and things like this, the large gatherings being limited right now for folks in the community is trying to get people further away from each other. So the idea behind warmer weather isn't necessarily that it's the temperature that's the difference. Is it perhaps the spacing of people? And we're less likely to cough or sneeze on somebody when we're outside doing an activity than we are when we're in close quarters in the cold weather months.
So for the average listener, what is your explanation as to what the basic precautions they should be taking? Without, there are people, like they said earlier, that are on both ends of the spectrum, scared, not going to go outside, and then the people that are like, this is nothing, I'm going to go and lick door handles, like they don't care.
Sure.
What is the basic precautions we should all be taking?
During any season, and quite honestly, during any time of the year, we should be washing our hands, you know, and that's
sad that we have to say that.
It
yeah.
seems like a right. big, you know, duh kind of moment, but this is one of those things that, especially during a time like this, this is a virus that, again, you can get cough or sneeze on somebody and give it to them that way. But you can also cough or sneeze onto a surface. And we know the virus probably lives on surfaces for minutes to hours, perhaps even longer, depending upon the surface. Hmm. So the importance of hand washing is a big deal. You touch a surface, you get the virus on your hand, then you touch your face, which we all do a lot. That's the scenario where we're inoculating or infecting ourselves. And it's really why hand washing is the cornerstone of this. I think on that spectrum of sort of I'm going to control the things I can control to panic, I'm certainly on the control what you can control piece. Hand washing is part of that. If you're sick, stay home. If you've got a cough, cover your cough. Don't be coughing on everybody else. And, you know, if you can stay, if you're in one of those groups that has more risk, so we know being older, and unfortunately older is described as older than 60 in the studies coming out of China. If you have pre-existing medical conditions like heart disease, like lung disease, like diabetes, high blood pressure, all of those put you at greater risk for the more severe complications of COVID-19, things like getting hospitalized, things like landing on the ventilator, even dying of this virus. All of those you're at higher risk for those with those other conditions. So if you're one of those people that has those problems, you want to be a little more cautious than the average person. So in addition to all of the hand washing, in addition to all of the things that we're doing to try to prevent virus spread in the community, you may want to be more cautious about where you're going and being in these large group settings. That said, people need to carry on. You got to carry on with your business. And I've said this probably 1,000 times in the last week, control the things you can control and worry less about sort of the panic in the community. And you know, you're going to hear increasingly from our health department this concept of social distancing. You know, we know that instead of shaking hands coming in this morning, we bumped elbows. The 6-foot radius around an individual is probably where you're able to sneeze or cough with efficacy, right? So you're not going to be able to cough beyond that point. And as a result, the droplets from this virus really don't land outside of that space. So the whole idea behind social distancing is to create more space between people and not have the virus transmit that way. You recognize, though, even with that, you'll need to do all the little things, the hand washing and all of that stuff.
Is there a light at the end of the tunnel that, you know, for people who are like, you know, I've been on both scales because, you know, I have, you know, just I'm weird. But is there a light at the end of the tunnel for the people that are absolutely losing their mind?
We will get through this. I am confident of that. This is, you know, looking a lot like a really bad seasonal flu year and then some right now. And we'll see where this ends up shaking out. That said, we will get through this. And I think, you know, to try to get people back onto that end of the spectrum where control the things you can control, take a deep breath, we're going to be okay.
Let's talk future vaccine for a second, because currently there's not one. In the legendary film Outbreak, Dustin Hoffman and Cuba Gooding Jr. find the host monkey, and they have the vaccine in about 15 minutes. I get that producing maybe billions, theoretically, maybe a billion, 2 billion, 3 billion, whatever, how many vaccines we would need. The production time is crazy, but everything I keep reading is saying that a possible vaccine is maybe still a year away. Why? Talk about how that process from figuring out the puzzle to getting it in production and getting it out takes a year or more.
Yep. So what's different this time around compared to SARS in 2003 is we were able to sequence the virus within the first month of discovering it, which is remarkable and a big gain, you know, compared to 14, 15, 17 years ago, I guess, in this case. The challenge now is looking for targets for a vaccine and then testing whether it's safe in humans. So, you know, it'll likely go through the usual vaccine pathways, right? So you'll test it in an animal model and then start introducing it at different doses into the human, into different human populations. That takes a while. You can't do that really quickly, or you risk introducing a vaccine to the general population that's not safe and you can actually do more harm than good.
Dr. Mark Sanis, again, is our guest, infectious disease physician at Park Nicollet and senior medical director for medical specialties at Health Partners, and hopefully by the end of this interview, my personal doctor. this is a tough question for you to answer, I'm sure, because we're talking about people's livelihoods, okay? But I'm going to ask you some direct questions about scenarios. If you were scheduled to go on a plane on vacation today, would you go?
Yeah, great question. We've been getting this one for a week with all the spring break stuff that's going on right now. If you'd have asked me that question 3 days ago, I would have gone. And I think the biggest change now is with the increased travel restrictions that were put on Western Europe, it's really created a little more trepidation about travel, just because you wonder if you will get back from your destination based on new restrictions that may be coming down. At present, you know, most of the rest of the world, it is safe to travel to. I think the big risk that I would worry about, though, is being able to get back into the United States.
What if it's Las Vegas in 12 days?
Exactly, right.
At present, the domestic travel, I think, is a different conversation.
Okay. I think you don't have any qualms of us going to Vegas on the 25th?
Again, this is individual risk tolerance,
sure,
kind of conversation.
I love risk.
I saw an interview with Dr. Tony Fauci, who many of you probably have seen. He's the director of the National Institutes of Health and probably the smartest infectious disease guy that I know. They asked him the same question on CNN or one of these other venues this week, and he said he would think twice about traveling by airplane, mostly because he's working 19-hour days right now, I think was his answer. But,
right, yeah.
You know, it really becomes an individual risk tolerance question.
And I know, Hawk, you have your hand up. Can I ask a quick follow-up to the airplane thing? If somebody's getting on a plane today, outside of washing their hands, what should they be doing literally on the plane?
Yeah,
in terms of what should you be touching? Should you be wiping things down? What should you bring? What's your game plan if you have to travel?
Yeah, so being a compulsive infectious disease guy at baseline, even the rest of the time when we're not in the middle of a COVID-19 outbreak, I'm probably one of those guys that's wiping down the tray in mm-hmm. front of them. And I travel with kids, so wiping down all of the stuff that is around them as well. I think the it's a reasonable thing to do. I see the Clorox wipes on the table here. I think
those are mine.
It's a reasonable
you
thing.
You can have one if you need one. Yeah, he'll share them.
I wash my hands a lot. We have carrying something like that with you on an airplane and wiping down your space, I think, is a great idea. I think people worry a lot about the air on an airplane. Remember, this is a virus that travels about 6 feet from someone that's coughing or sneezing. That's the group that you need to worry about on the airplane, is those that are around you, and then the surfaces that you come in contact with. What's, you know, 12 rows in front of you is probably not a concern with this virus. This is not measles or smallpox or one of these other viruses that is very efficiently transferred in the air. This is one that lands about six, you know, between 3 and 6 feet away, and if you're outside of that range, it's really the surfaces that you're coming in contact with that you worry about.
That's on a large scale. Let me ask you something on a small scale, which really is affecting people monetarily and their livelihoods. Would you go to a restaurant with your family?
I would, and I will. I think we have plans this evening.
Awesome. Sweet. Where are you going?
Yeah, do you have room for one more?
My kids,
are you picking up the tab?
Yeah, my kids usually vote pizza, so we'll see where we land.
I like pizza.
Yeah. Awesome.
Oh, pizza's awesome.
Would you, a different way to ask this, is there a reason, a legitimate reason, for people to be stocking up on every last roll of toilet paper?
I don't understand the toilet paper.
Right.
Okay.
I really don't. This is not a gastrointestinal illness.
Right, right.
You get the wipes and the disinfectants,
exactly.
The hand sanitizer, right. All those kind of things.
Yep.
That makes sense. The paper towels even kind of make sense, right? Because you're wiping things down.
Yep. So, but in all seriousness, the bunker mentality, sort of the stock up mentality that I think we're seeing, really should be about, all right, if I can't get out of the house because I'm sick or because I'm taking care of somebody that's sick, having enough food around to be able to manage that scenario for a few days is sort of the approach that I've been taking with patients and folks that are asking that question. I don't think we need months of stockpiles in our house.
Gotcha.
One last thing in regards to that, though. I'm sorry, Saucy.
No,
one last thing. People wearing surgical masks.
The masks are for folks who are sick. So whether that's in an airport, on an airplane, or around. And the idea there is preventing transmission of somebody that has this to somebody else. It doesn't really work very well for all the reasons I talked about on the airplane for somebody to be walking around with a mask in the community. The vast majority of folks in that scenario, this virus may be getting in and around the mask that you're wearing all day long anyway, and your exposure is probably more likely off of a surface in that scenario.
So let me go back to what I asked maybe a half an hour ago, because, and maybe I could be immediately wrong, which would be fun. When the NCAA announced that they were going to go fanless, but they were going to have immediate family and essential staff, so playing a game in front of 100 or 200 people, made sense to me. I get it. And then, of course, the NBA cancels because Rudy Gobert gets it, and they basically say, all right, we're not going to do this. Let's just shut it down. So then 24 hours later or so, the NCAA says, forget the whole fanless thing. We're also canceling. You just said you're going to restaurants, you know, that airplanes domestically, not the end of the world. Would you have felt good about the NCAA doing 100 or 200 people as opposed to 20,000? Like, do you think that would have been safe to do and okay in terms of, you know, flattening this curve of coronavirus?
Yeah, it's a really good question. I think it's a safer plan, certainly in that scenario with several hundred people in the building. That said, I think they're trying to send a message. Public health is kind of trumps all of the other issues that are out there, you know, our desire to really get into March Madness and some of the things that we take, you know, this is really a fun time of year for college basketball fans. I think the large group gatherings, that was a no-brainer right now.
So, and that's a consensus, right? Every health official basically in the country is saying, if we want to squash this, our best chance is to buzzkill major group events, regardless of where and when, just let's just get out in front of it and shut it all
exactly
down.
Exactly right, and it comes back to what I talked about, sort of if you can limit the number of people at the top of the funnel, the folks that are actually getting this disease, our healthcare system will be able to handle a surge. We just can't handle this huge spike right now. So if we can even slow this down,
gotcha.
We talk about flattening the curve of this mm-hmm. of this epidemic in the U.S. If you can accomplish that, the healthcare system can continue to hum along at capacity, but be able to take care of everybody. I think what we're seeing in Italy right now is a healthcare system that is overwhelmed and unable to take care of that 20%, the folks that are needing that higher level of care in the hospital setting, and they're having to make some bad, tough decisions. Mm.
Again, first of all, Dr. Mark Sanis, this has been excellent. Can you stay
Unreal.
For one more segment, please?
Sure.
Thank you very much.
My new hero.
You got to go.
I got to go.
Do you have one more question before you go? Feel free. I'm sorry I went to break, but if you got another one, go ahead.
Nope. I just love that you project the calm and you say, listen, control what you can control. We're going to be fine. We're going to get through this. More people need to hear that. So thank you so much.
And more importantly, he told us to go to Vegas. I don't even care what he says. If he would have said stay home, I would have been like, get out of here. Yeah. Go back to work. Who invited you anyway?
It was hockey.
He said go to Vegas, so I'm going to Vegas.
Love you guys. See you next Friday.
Love you, John. Take care, buddy. Again, that's Dr. Mark Sanis, infectious disease physician at Park Nicollet and senior medical director for medical specialties at Health Partners. One more segment with him. I'll get to some of your questions from Twitter, and we'll have some more ourselves. I want to say thanks to Jimmy Bellamy as well for making this possible. Thank you for reaching out to me from Health Partners to make sure this happened. This has been great. We'll do more. Again, last chance, if you have questions, I'll try to get to as many as I can. Chris_hockey on Twitter. We'll be right back.
I have wandered through this world, and as each moment has unfurled, I've been waiting.
Again, the bills still got to be paid. I understand that. My name is Chris Hockey, and I'm here to tell you one way to take care of a big bill and really, really do something smart financially for yourself and for your family. And this is something I did do. I can look you in the eye and tell you. I took advantage of Lightstream.com's credit card consolidation loans. And you can get a loan from $5,000 to $100,000. Doesn't matter how many credit card bills you've got. Round that number all together there and get a loan for that amount and then pay those credit cards off. I had four. I took care of it in one swoop with a credit card consolidation loan from Lightstream. Why did I do that? Well, each of those credit cards had an APR, an interest rate of over 20%. I was paying so much more money on that. That's number one. Number two, the APR on a Lightstream credit card consolidation loan can be as low as 5.95% APR with auto pay. So again, for my situation, from four payments to one, from four different giant APRs to one loan with a small APR. There's no fees. You can get your money as soon as the day you apply. This is easy and it works. Get a special interest rate discount just for listening to the Power Trip here. By doing this, go to lightstream.com/hockey, my last name. LIGHTSTREAM, lightstream.com/hockey. Subject to credit approval. Rate includes 0.50% autopay, 0.050% autopay discount. Terms and conditions apply and offers are subject to change without notice. Visit lightstream.com/hockey for more information.
KFAN. Total traffic.
From the Holiday Station Stores Traffic Center, here's a look at the roads. Not much going on. Very light traffic volume. Highway 10 heading eastbound at Highway 610. We've got a stall on the right shoulder. No problems on 94. It's clear on 494, 694. 394 remains clear. It's issue-free on the crosstown. 35W looking good. 35E, no issues. That's traffic on the fan, sponsored by Panera Bread. Panera Bread is introducing unlimited coffee for just $8.99 a month. You can have coffee before your coffee, coffee after your coffee, or coffee with a side of coffee. With Panera's new unlimited coffee subscription, your cup is always full. Restrictions apply. Participating cafes only.
At T-Mobile, you can get a free Samsung Galaxy S25G when you buy one and add a line. Two new Samsung phones make a night out better than ever.
He's asleep.
The sitter's here. Let's go.
Take close-ups from far away with 30 times zoom.
Wow, this shot makes it look like we have great seats.
Totally.
Post, snap, and live stream all your favorite moments.
Parents' night out. And share.
And indoors or outdoors, T-Mobile's got you covered with the first and only nationwide 5G network.
Thank you, babysitters. Good night.
Buy one Samsung Galaxy S25G and get one free when you add a line. Plus, get two new lines of unlimited on T-Mobile's network with 5G access included for just $90 a month with AutoPay. Hurry in to a T-Mobile store today.
Customers may notice lower speeds and further reduction if using more than 50 gigs a month. Video typically at 480p, plus taxes and fees. Phone via 24 credits for well-qualified buyers. If you cancel before receiving 24 credits, you may owe up to full amount of required finance agreement on each device. Contact us. See 5G coverage compatibility and access details at T-Mobile.com.
Welcome back to Pronto's Quiz Show. Ready for your final question?
Let's do it, Wade.
Name the one thing customers can always expect from Pronto Heating.
Easy. Service that hustle.
Oh, I'm sorry. The correct answer is service with hustle. Join
hey,
us again.
Wait, that's what I said.
No, you said service that hustles. The correct answer is service with hustle.
Same thing.
Today's show is brought to you by...
For service with hustle,
yeah!
Call Pronto Heating and Air Conditioning.
Seriously? I lost on a technicality?
Find us online at prontoheat.com.
LutherAuto.com. That's LutherAuto.com for all of your auto needs. Of course, Luther has you covered because they have 37 locations. They have essentially every make and model you can imagine. somewhere under the Luther umbrella. So if you're looking to buy, start shopping around at lutherauto.com. What's even better, of course, if you know exactly what you want, great. That'll be easier. Find a Luther dealership that has it. Get that great customer service, great Luther everyday low prices, and move on. It's the best. I'm a Luther guy for sure. My vehicle's a Luther vehicle. My wife's it. And the great thing about Luther, even if you don't buy from them, they will buy from you. Turns out the best place to buy a car is also the best place to sell your car. They like to say, we buy at Luther. So you drive into Luther with a vehicle that you'd like to flat out sell to them. They give you an offer in about 15 minutes. It's fast. It's simple. It's safe. It's awesome. Great customer service. You're going to get a great deal if you accept, and you probably will. Luther handles all of the paperwork. So it's very simple. No hassles, no hurdles like selling it yourself online. Find them online right now at lutherauto.com. We buy at Luther.
Meat Sauce here. If I win initials today, you can go to any one of the 5 Ouellette bakeries, and when you buy 6 donuts, get 6 free. Tell the Meat Sauce won initials when you go to Ouellette Bakery this weekend to get 6 free donuts when you buy 6.
This report is sponsored by Allstate. With an Allstate agent, you get a local expert and help finding the best coverage for you. And because they live in your community, you can always count on them to be there when you need them most. Plus, when you bundle home and auto, you can save. So call your local Allstate agent today. Are you in good hands?
Fan forecast.
Partly sunny and upper 30s today, tomorrow, and Sunday.
The Fan.
Welcome back to the Power Trip Morning Show. It's 7:28. The initials will happen less than an hour from now.
They have not been postponed. They have not been canceled. The initials will go on at 8:15 as scheduled. And again, once the Rage Against the Machine concert got postponed, I don't really care about anything else.
Yeah.
I don't really care that Marty Gellner's life has been flipped upside down like Fresh Prince of Bel-Air because there's no sports for the next couple of months.
Yeah.
Marty, Dr. Mark Sanis. Marty Gellner.
Yes, pleasure to meet you, doctor. I listened to the last segment, and I was very calmed by you. So I thank you for that, and I bet there are a lot of people thinking the same thing. Like, this guy is really smart, and he's not panicking, so maybe we're going to be okay.
Thanks for having me in.
Again, I got to say the title because it's awesome. Dr. Mark Sanis, infectious disease physician at Park Nicollet and senior medical director for medical specialties at Health Partners. One more segment. We got some Twitter questions. I know Marnie probably has some as well.
I do.
AJ, though, has one right behind me. AJ, go.
I'm going to package this up with a broad question first to let you go afterwards if you want, and then get the specific one. There's a lot of myths out there about this, or are there any of them that are dangerous or that you want to write the record on? One that I specifically want to know is there's a narrative that's being spun that COVID-19 has actually been in the States or been around for months now, but we weren't testing for it. So people had it, maybe recovered from it, some maybe didn't, but we just didn't have the mindset to test for it before the outbreak in China. Is that true? And is there anything else that's dangerous out there that you'd like to write the record on?
So I'll take the one around the, has it been circulating here for months? Again, honest answer is we don't know because we haven't really been looking. Based on the number of folks that are coming down with respiratory illness that are consistent with COVID-19 around the country, I have a hard time believing it's been here for a long time. And I think we have pretty good data saying this came out of China in that Wuhan area in December of 2019. So I think it's unlikely it's been anywhere prior to that. Other myths that are out there, you know, I think the myth that I would dispel is I'm helpless to this and that I can't do anything about this on an individual basis. I think it seems really crazy to talk about things like covering your cough and washing your hands being impactful from a public health perspective, but I think they are. This is how you go about trying to stem the bolus effect on the front end of this epidemic, meaning, again, this flattening of the curve, this idea that the little things we do right now, even if we slow this down, it's enough that allows the healthcare system in the United States to handle the number of folks that are going to get this and ultimately need hospitalization and higher level of care.
How much different is this whole thing if it had started here?
It's a great question in that would we have perhaps even been more vulnerable to widespread community transmission faster? We at least saw this coming a little bit. We saw the experience in China. We saw what was happening in Italy. Even if people weren't taking it seriously, we had started ramping up. At Health Partners, we had started a command center approach for travelers that were coming back from China. How are we going to handle these people as they came back into clinic with respiratory illness? all the way back in January. And being able to be planful about this has made a difference, I think, in the U.S., and I'm hoping that we're able to blunt that initial kind of bolus effect that we see across the United States as a result. Time will tell on that one.
I have several questions, but I realize we're one at a time.
No, go for it.
I'm not even sure where to prioritize. My world is in the NBA. Rudy Gobert was sort of the domino that really brought the nation to a stop two nights ago. How is it possible that when NBA players, as much as they are in physical contact and sweat and share locker rooms and are high-fiving and are exchanging so much personal space, that Rudy Gobert and Donovan Mitchell are the only two players to have tested positive for coronavirus? Of all the trainers and coaches and opponents and teammates, with as infectious as we hear this is, that just seems stunning to me.
Again, the most efficient way we transmit this virus from one person to the next is coughing and sneezing on them. So this is a group that, you know, if they're sick, they're
not
probably
sweating.
No, it isn't. And even though there's a lot of contact, physical contact, and yes, you can probably have coronavirus on your skin and put somebody at risk by being in contact with them. That's why we're encouraging people. We've been doing elbow bumps all morning around here. And again, it's the hands that are so important in this. And I don't know that some of those other contacts are as relevant. And I think it's why we're not seeing widespread infections. I saw that one of the Premier League teams was also on quarantine in mm-hmm. Western Europe during all of this. And you know, sure, someone is bound to get it, but I don't think it's that physical contact.
Okay, so that doesn't surprise you, because I thought when one athlete has it, 75% of the league will have it. That's not accurate.
I would say that's not accurate, and I think the experience has been those close quarters, right? So that's where team travel stuff matters, you know, being inside of that 6-foot radius around a lot of other people. That's where I think the more efficient spread would be, but not on the field.
I just read last night that in the state of Ohio, there are, I don't even remember how many confirmed cases, 55 we'll say, but that a medical person in Ohio said, I believe there are 100,000 people in our state who have it, who are either not showing symptoms or have not tested positive yet. And I was like, what?
Yeah, it's hard to make sort of these broad statements when you aren't able to back them up, either with any science that says, all right, if we did a community sampling, you know, did the COVID-19 test on everybody in the community, how much of the iceberg are we seeing right now? And it as we expand testing in Minnesota and elsewhere around the country, the thing I would tell people is do not be surprised by the number of cases going up significantly this week in Minnesota and the rest of the U.S. just because we are expanding testing. We were really strict about who got tested early on in this, largely out of a scarcity of testing kits being available, right? As we have ramped up the production and the capabilities of being able to test people, we are now testing much more broadly with much looser criteria. We are gonna find a lot more of this, whether it's, you know, 50 to 100,000 scale, you know, sort of changes. Mm-hmm. I have a suspicion that's probably not gonna be the case, but it may be thousands of cases in the U.S. Who knows? We'll see what this
week brings. So that number will go up inevitably, but we should not necessarily be scared by that. Is my translation
take
of what you said.
Take it seriously, but recognize this is going to happen. This is an expected phenomenon. When we started seeing cases in Minnesota this week, this was something we knew was going to happen, just from the number of folks that are infected around the world. Even if we evolve to evidence that we have community spread of this infection in the metro, in the greater Minnesota, this is something we have a plan for how we're going to try to stem this bolus effect on the front end, right? We're going to try to flatten this curve, this concept of, you know, the number of people that are ultimately infected in the U.S., we want to reduce that or at least slow it down on the front end so our healthcare system can handle those that need the higher level of care.
Dr. Mark Sanis, again, infectious disease physician at Park Nicollet and senior medical director for medical specialties at Health Partners. A lot of questions around this. So from Twitter, if you were in charge, let me start like this. We know the argument about not sending kids to school is to keep them from getting it and infecting people around them. But we also know that part of the reason not to close the schools is because we need our healthcare professionals working and not at home taking care of their kids. We understand both sides of it. If you were in charge, Mark Sanis, what would you do? Would you close the schools or keep them open?
that's when I really, I think this is where you follow the lead of the Minnesota Department of Health. I think based on lack of community transmission of COVID-19, I certainly understand why that has not been a recommendation at the state level to date. When we have evidence of community transmission of COVID-19, I think that'll be another conversation that I would look for our health department leaders to make. I think the decisions made to date, I support them and understand why we're in this state we're in. You know, regarding the if schools do close, you know, I think I do encourage people to be planful about that, though. So what does this look like? Are you able to work remotely? Have you done sort of a test drive on what that looks like in whatever job that you're in? We talk about that in at Health Partners in our clinics and in our office settings now. If somebody needed to be home with kids, what could they do from home and continue doing their work? What's that contingency plan look like? And that's where I tell people, get that plan B. You know, what does this look like if your kids are home and start thinking about that?
Another really heavily asked question on Twitter. Can we give to or receive this from our pets as far as we know?
I think the honest answer is we don't know. If it behaves like other coronaviruses, the answer is maybe. And might even be probably, but I'm not a veterinarian.
All right, so you mentioned earlier one of the unknowns is whether or not you're capable of getting it once you get it once, right? Like if you're immune to it later. So with that unknown being part of this question, how do we project the life cycle of this run of coronavirus? And then how do we know if it's a one-time phenomenon or if it's something we're going to have to worry about seasonally or down the road?
Yeah, really good question. And I think, again, unknown only in the sense that we – humans have not seen this virus before. So the closest example I can give you is in 2009 when we saw a novel influenza virus sort of, you know, occasionally influenza strains, flu strains, reassort and kind of become something different than what we're used to. In 2009, H1N1 was that type of influenza and went around the world in a couple of months like this, had a mortality rate that was higher than what we were used to. So it was a bad flu year in that respect. COVID-19 is similar in the respect that it is likely going to infect a vulnerable population like we were back in 2009 and we are more susceptible to getting it, right? Because we haven't seen this before. What we can do though is try to slow this down over months and to ultimately answer your question, how long is this going to go? Could this season go beyond sort of the normal respiratory virus season, last through the summer and even into next fall? I think the answer is maybe, and might even be probably again, but we'll see. That's why it's important what we do right now in sort of stemming this initial hit, if you will, is so important.
Last thing for you, and again, thank you for so much time. I honestly could go on all day, but you've answered almost every question in one way or another. Here's the last one. We know, going right back to it at the very base level for each human that is listening to this, wash your hands, cover your cough. That's what we need to learn mostly. Do your best, but try not to panic about things you can't control. What do you hope we learn as a race, as the human race, from this finally happening on the scale that it's happening? What do you hope, as somebody in this business, we finally freaking figure out?
I think attention to some of the population level kind of public health measures and infection prevention measures, you know, this has been an area of consternation for those of us in infectious disease for a long time, right? Why don't we aggressively fund prevention programs in public health and in infectious disease more than what we do? You know, the examples given regarding where we spend a lot of money and where we don't spend a lot of money right now. And I think the public health sector and infectious disease is an area that has been woefully underfunded for a long time. Vaccination strategies, you'd love to see a vaccine program that's so robust that based off of our early experiences from SARS or this Middle Eastern respiratory syndrome, MERS, another coronavirus from about 5-6 years ago, we would have the capabilities to ramp up that vaccine capacity very quickly and make a response to this happen much faster than anything that we're able to do right now.
Can I spike it with one last question?
Yeah, feel free.
Just in terms of short-term protocol. So almost what we started with, but let's just go first full circle for people that are just joining now. So if somebody thinks they're a little bit sick today and we don't want to bog down the system, especially the 80% of the people that are just going to have this go through them 2 or 3 days, right? if you're feeling sick today, what should people do? And, you know, when should they call? When should they actually go in? What should people do in general if they're not feeling well and when they just woke up?
Sure. I think the honest answer on whether do I need to be tested or not, I'll you know, maybe do a shameless plug for an online tool that we use at Health Partners called virtuel.com. It's a 24/7 clinic. Basically, go on there. We're offering free screenings for folks that want to plug in their scenario and see if they should be tested. I think it has been a great assist to our urgent cares that are overloaded right now with folks wanting to come in and be tested. The vast majority of folks with mild respiratory symptoms, I would say if you normally wouldn't go in to the clinic, sit tight and not go in. Unless,
what's that line? Like, what's the level of concern where you should say they should come
you
in?
You know, if you're having significant shortness of breath or if you're one of those groups that's higher risk, I'm not going to tell that group to stay home.
Gotcha.
But, you know, sitting around the table here, most of us, if we have cough, cold symptoms and even a little bit of low-grade fever, I don't think we should be running in to the clinic right now, especially when they are as full as they are. Number one, your likelihood of getting exposed to something potentially may be greater than actually anything information that you may glean. The other thing is look for some opportunities in the next few days. If your symptoms aren't too bad, we have drive-up capabilities for testing that are coming really across the metro. And this is where one of those proud moments to really look at the health systems in town and how they share information in times of crisis. Really have done a nice job with sharing capabilities and now being able to potentially drive up, have a test done in the parking lot. If you aren't having severe symptoms, those with mild symptoms will be able to be tested from their car and get a result back, you know, at a period of time later without ever having to sit in a waiting room.
Mm. Wow. Will you make sure that they get us that information so we can spread that around so people know when they can do that? What a huge thing. Again, Jimmy Bellamy, thank you over there for making this happen. And Dr. Mark Sanis, I'd love to give you tickets to a game or something, but there are no games. But thank you is the best I can do for all your time. Again, you mentioned the best place to go is the Minnesota Department of Health for the most up-to-date factual information. You still stand by that, right?
Very much so.
And as of today, March 13th, 2020, you are green lighting the Power Trip Vegas trip on the 25th, right?
That's
the only reason we had you in. We just need you to back us.
Oh, listen. Listen to that.
Oh,
listen,
thanks,
Dr. Mark.
Yeah, thanks.
Thanks for having me.
We're going to be okay.
It wouldn't be the Power Trip Morning Show if we didn't end with this.
What a story, Mark.
Yep, that's exactly
nice
right.
Job, Mark.
Yeah, doctor, thank you so much.
Thank you.
What a great thing you've done for us. Thank you.
Oh, hi, Mark.
And you can imagine, you can podcast an entire thing. AJ, you can watch it as well. You put the whole thing up, right? From Twitch. So just KFAN.com. Infectious disease physician at Park Nicollet and senior medical director for medical specialties at Health Partners, Dr. Mark Sanis has been our guest. We'll break and come right back. It's the Power Trip Morning Show on The Fan.
The Fan.